But when I realized that Jesus was willing to walk away and let other people walk away, it changed my life. And I could see Jesus letting toxic or closed-minded people go and then investing in the reliable people, his disciples.
Welcome to the Focus on the Family broadcast, helping families thrive.
You know, this is a interesting and difficult subject that we're going to talk about today, but toxic people are around us. And I think one of the goals I've always had is don't be that. Don't be a toxic person. And what does it mean to be toxic? We're going to cover some of that today with Gary Thomas. But, you know, reading the material, John, this morning early, which is my habit,
yes.
You know, I get up early, 6 a.m., and I'm reading for today's program. Jean and I were talking about it, and she related a story that I didn't even know, but before we met, she was at a church in Southern California, and she said she probably had 3 or 4 relationships with women in this church that were just really demanding. And, you know, what she said, they were toxic, that they knew she was a soft touch, and they were pulling from her and demanding from her certain mm-hmm. relationship attributes that Jean was getting tired of. You know, it's exhausting to be around people that are always demanding of you. So I'm looking forward to a very difficult discussion today. You know, as Christians, dealing with people who are hurtful or hostile toward us can be really challenging. And encounters with toxic people, although maybe rare, they do exist. And we need to understand how Jesus would want us to deal with them. And we're going to cover that today again with Gary Thomas.
And Gary is a prolific author and speaker. He addresses topics of marriage, parenting, and the Christian life. And he's part of the teaching team and a writer in residence at Second Baptist Church in Houston, Texas. And he certainly is one of the most popular guests we ever have here, Jim. His book that we're going to be covering today is When to Walk Away, Finding Freedom from Toxic People. And we do have that, of course, at focusonthefamily.com/broadcast.
Gary, great to have you back to Focus.
Well, thank you for having me back.
How about that for a yearbook mention? You know, the most popular guy who writes about toxic people. Man, that may be an interesting place to start. You know, we tend to divide ourselves between rough people and maybe easier going people. I'm sure in high school and junior high, we're learning a lot about that. Is that where this all starts?
I was voted in junior high before we went to high school. They had the Hall of Fame ones, right? And I didn't get any of the glamour ones. I didn't get most popular in my dreams. I didn't get most athletic. I mean, look at me.
Hey, you are a runner.
And I didn't get most likely to succeed. I was way down on the bottom where it said most polite. So I guess I was the one that was often taking advantage of that because I was so clueless. But I think what led to this is my growing passion. This is part of being part of a church. I believe every Christian's ministry matters. I'm not talking about professional ministry. I'm talking about the ministry of friendship, the ministry of parenting, the ministry of riding the subway or working, you know, Whether it's the ball field or anywhere. And because our ministry matters, our health matters. And if we're having this constant drain on our health, we're missing great opportunities for ministry. This might be a silly story, but my wife has been after me for years to do an elimination diet. Have you guys ever heard of that? I can imagine your
eliminate the food in front of you?
Well, basically it means you eliminate anything that you like to eat.
The notion is
there are foods that are toxic that gradually make you sick, and you go through these blood tests, and they say these are troublesome areas, and then you go through it. And so I finally did it just because I thought, in those marriage situations, I don't know that I'm going to have any peace until I finally do this. And I picked the worst time to do it. I didn't realize it's 3 weeks where you can't eat hardly anything. And it was over my birthday. And just, I love cake and ice cream. I mean, it is like God, family, cake and ice cream. Right,
wow.
right here. But I can only do it like 2 or 3 times a year. It's just the calories and everything, and I know it's not that healthy. So
I thought you were going to say 2 or 3 times a day.
No, that's what makes it so special. And so it's over my birthday, and this couple had us over. They didn't know I was on this stupid elimination diet. And she made my perfect birthday cake and ice cream, and I'm watching 5 other people eat my cake and ice cream wishing me happy birthday, right? Because if you break it, you have to go back and start over. I mean,
but it is cake.
It was.
You could break it.
It smelled good.
It may be worth it.
And so that night, I remember telling Lisa, I said, "Man, when I get done, you have no idea. I'm gonna enjoy it." She goes, "I'm just gonna gorge." She goes, "Lisa, you can't do that." I said, "What do you mean?" And she goes, "It takes weeks to break an elimination diet." I said, "What do you mean?" I go, "Like, what happened?" She goes, "Well, for instance, the first day you tested for cranberries. So we'll give you cranberries for a couple days, see if you have a reaction, and then you introduce foods one by one." I don't even like cranberries. I'm not avoiding food.
You can eliminate that quick.
You're off the list.
I go, what doctor from hell thought up this diet? But the point is, the point is that there are these foods that may just be draining your energy and make them sick. You need to identify them so that you can live with more energy and renewed purpose. And that's what I think is true of ministry. When I think of what a young mom is going through with a baby and a toddler, which literally may be the most tiring position in life, and then a husband and all that together. And then when you see what toxic people can drain people, this is an all-star couple. I mean, he's type A, leader in a couple organizations. You meet him all the time.
High achievers.
Jim, you might be the type.
No, I'm not.
Where he excelled in sports and everything, and the wife, and they're published, and they're well-known. And I'm laughing as they're recounting the time when a woman rings their doorbell. They drop to the floor. Don't say anything. Be quiet. I mean, they're hoping because, you know, toxic people look through windows. And I'm thinking, how are you, these accomplished, healthy people, but that's what toxic people can reduce you to, where you are literally hiding in your house, trying not to make a sound, hoping they don't look through the windows. Man. But I've seen so many of God's people drained. False guilt, a false sense of responsibility, misunderstanding of some scriptures, and it's making them not just miserable, but less effective. And it was just eye-opening to me when I looked at Jesus's pattern of ministry and method of ministry, things that I can't tell you how many times I've read the New Testament. Suddenly my eyes were opened. It completely changed the way I looked at life and ministry to accept the reality of toxic people and look at how Jesus handled them.
Yeah, and you have definitely answered my first question, which was, what does toxicity in people look like? I think you have done that perfectly. But and this one might even seem like an odd question, but I'd love for you to explain why you believe toxic people are part of Satan's strategy to sideline us. I mean, that sounds so lofty and spiritual, but is that true?
Here's where I think it is so subtle and clever. Satan can't get God's people to stop caring because God's Spirit makes us care. Mm. I know there are a lot of cliches about the church, but I see churches filled. I've been in over 500 pulpits. I see Christians sacrificially giving and serving. They're the ones who are there helping others. There are a few outliers that can be so mean and rejecting. It's not even a tiny minority of the Christians I see. And so since Satan knows he can't get them to stop caring, and he knows how God can use any common believer who's been a believer for 3 hours can begin to list his friends, because the Holy Spirit makes any believer a powerful witness for the kingdom. Instead of getting us to pour that caring out on these fields that are ready to produce great crops, he wants us to pour that care straight into the gutter of toxic people who will resent the care, who reject the truth, who won't be transformed, and will turn on us and make us pay for our good intentions, so that we can be so taken up with trying to placate toxic people or recover from toxic people that we're not investing in reliable people. And for me, if I could just get more versed in the scriptures, be more surrendered to the Holy Spirit, not have compromise in my life, be expectant and open to the work of God, that somehow everybody I met would have this powerful encounter with Jesus and recognize the truth of Jesus and say, oh, of course. And then
behave like Jesus.
Right. But when a friend finally saw me hitting my head up against the wall again and again, he's a counselor of over 35 years. He knows scriptures and he knows people. And he finally said to me, Gary, I want you to read the book of Luke. Count how many times Jesus walked away from people or let people walk away from him. Encounters where the people weren't changed. Well, I think I've said to you before, I'm not clinically OCD, but I live in the neighborhood right next door to it. So
you can visit it from time to time.
So a counselor tells me to count Luke. I got to do all four Gospels, right? I want to get everybody's perspective. I count, and I wrote down everyone. I counted 41 occasions. Now, the Synoptic Gospels, the common ones contain some of the same instances, but there's still over a couple dozen distinct instances where Jesus interacted with someone and he let that person walk away, or he chose to walk away. Sometimes blatantly toxic, not always toxic. But when I realized that Jesus was willing to walk away and let other people walk away, it changed my life. And I could see Jesus letting toxic or closed-minded people go and then investing in the reliable people, his disciples. And it's where we started. So I wanted to pour that water onto fields that were fertile, that needed irrigation, that would produce a crop, and not pour that attention and focus into the gutter. Because here's what I found. It'd be interesting if you guys have any different experience. When I look back at every truly toxic person I spent time with, they're not the better for it, and I'm the worse for it.
Huh.
And so I just look back over the course of my life, and I hope I can get some younger listeners saying, you know what, you will, when you're in your 50s, you're going to look at this like I did. Learn to find the reliable people, the ready people, the open people, the fruitful people. Invest your time there. That's the wise kingdom investment.
And I would think maybe the 80-20 rule applies here, but and this is something someone's got to be asking themselves. Well, how do you discern between a toxic person and just a hard-to-get-along-with person? And we can quickly kind of put somebody in a category that God really does want us to be working with and talking with and influencing. So what's the definition of that toxic person that we should do what Jesus did and either walk away or let them walk away and not pursue them?
Okay. One of the big markers of toxic people is that they're controlling. They want you to do what they want you to do. And the reason this is so astonishing to me is how different God is. That he's a God who respects our choice. The Old Testament phrase, choose you this day whom you will serve, from right. Joshua. Jesus, in the New Testament, I stand at the door and knock. And the way that Jesus let others walk away, as powerful as God is, as always right, nobody is right 100% of the time like God is, he lets people walk away. He's not controlling. The New Testament talks about demonic possession, doesn't talk about God possession. Mm. Paul says the spirit of the prophets are subject to the control of the prophet. So if somebody is controlling you, they're trying to become a little God to you with a little g. That's a toxic thing. Secondly, they just have a murderous spirit. And I'm not just talking about killing us. They kill reputations. They kill friendships. They kill churches. They kill peace. They kill businesses, where you just see this wide swath of death. They destroyed that friendship. They made people afraid to go to the office there. They tore apart that small group. When you look at somebody's life and the fruit is just destruction after destruction, and then you compare it to God, who opens the Bible by creating life, who ends the Bible creating the new heavens and the new earth. Jesus saying, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. And Jesus said, Satan the thief comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. So if you see a lot of murder in their life, whether they're murdering your joy, your peace, your sense of sanity, that's a bad sign. Mm. And then finally, in Colossians 3, Paul lays out what is a very healthy thing when he says that Christians who are in a healthy situation are spiritually wired for compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, patience, and love.
The fruit of the Spirit.
The opposite, though, is this. Those who exhibit, and this is Colossians 3, 8, and 9, anger, rage, malice, slander, filthy language, and lying. And the difference is we might commit some of those. A woman who recognizes her husband or her son is getting addicted may unintentionally control, but it's out of positive, caring, loving concern. It's not a toxic thing.
It's correction.
But you recognize what you're doing and you want to get rid of it. For toxic people, They come alive when they're raging. They're never more fully awake than when they're lying or they're using filthy language. They're at their best when they're doing their worst. Mm. And you just see that for some reason, they love hate. And so if they're tearing you down, that's generally a bad concern. If you see controlling, a murderous spirit, and somebody who loves to hate, you're dealing with a toxic individual.
And I can just feel right now somebody is kind of, they're sitting with kind of hackles raised on the back of their neck. They're thinking of the person that you're describing, because it's just, it's a tense thing for us to deal with those people. Gary Thomas on Focus on the Family today, and the book is called When to Walk Away, Finding Freedom from Toxic People. Gary's doing a great job of describing that person, and we'll get into some of the practical things you can do when you encounter those folks. Get this book. It's available at Focus on the Family's website, or we're just a phone call away, and get a copy of the broadcast as well. You might want to share that with someone. We're at focusonthefamily.com/broadcast, and our number is 800-A-FAMILY.
Gary, you have a story, and you know, we all learn through story. Jesus taught us through parables, so I love this. But you have a story about a woman who was a fan. She liked one of your blog posts and probably gave it the thumbs up. But then something went wrong. What happened?
Well, my blog post is related to marriage mostly, and then family life. And so I dealt with an issue that I haven't published heavily about. It's not my focus, but I just said, as we're talking about marriages, we also need to be aware of this. And it's one that she's been writing about. It's been sort of her specialty. And at first, she seemed very appreciative and laudatory, and she said, here, you need to read my book on this, and you need to read this other person's book. And sometimes I'm honest to a fault. I don't know if you can say that, but I didn't want to say sure when I knew I went. I said, look, this was a one-time blog post. It's not going to be a specialty. I'm glad to have specialists out there. I'll refer people to specialists, but I can't promise you I'm going to read two books because I wrote this one blog post that I might not ever
so
blog about
again. So you're
being
really honest with this person, basically.
And she took it as a personal affront, and suddenly now I'm part of the problem. And she has not a big thing, but she had enough of a platform to marshal some other people. We're seeing attack reviews on Amazon. Obviously, I hadn't read the book, but they're going after two of my books on Amazon with attack reviews. Blog posts that are challenging me and saying I'm covering up my own evil behavior by calling it out in others. Even began attacking my wife, and my wife is great at walking away. She just doesn't get involved, but she finally did. And then they turned on her.
Oh, my goodness.
And that's when I realized I really need, and when you take on my wife, then it's easier for me to take the, from junior high, most polite guy shoes off and say, wait a minute, now this is
over the line,
a different situation entirely. And what helped me is others that had dealt with this person. You've had some guests on here. She's frustrated because she's never been on the show. And she thinks she should be on the, and you've had others address this topic, and it just hacks. She wants to be the ex. And the problem is she has some good stuff to share, but she takes pride in how many people have blocked her and how many people have written her, because she basically is this attack. And you will do what I want you to do, and you'll say what I want you to say, or you're going to pay the price. And I regret, you know, trying to placate her and the few people that she could marshal to go against that. I look back, it's wasted time. And I woke up one time, and I don't like to be too subjective. I get my revelation from Scripture. But you know how God makes Scripture come alive? And just convicted by God that it would be a better use of 10 minutes to try to write two sentences for a blog post than care what she or her ilk think about me. And it almost becomes comical. 2 months before When to Walk Away came out, I got an angry email about how harmful it is. Now, she hadn't read the book. Nobody had read the book. It hadn't been published yet. But she was pretty sure what she thought it probably said. I know this sounds crazy, but I'm literally quoting
it.
Her. And it was just this long, long email. How could you say? And I just, my assistant said, yeah, you had such a great response. I just did a short thing. I said, look, you haven't read it. You're making assumptions. do you realize how crazy this starts to sound? And I said, I hope you're not writing up authors like this. I go, this is just, and then she sent me two other emails, and I just, and a friend of mine just laughed and said, Gary, walk away. I mean, this is it. But it's just these people where you see this controlling, they like the conflict, they love to hate. And look, with focus, when you guys produce what you produce, a million times what I produce in a year, I could just imagine, I don't know that there's a show that doesn't raise some toxic hackles. And at some point, it's, we're going to speak the word that we believe that God has given us, and we've got to walk away. There can be constructive criticism, but you start to discern the toxic control. You must stop, or you got to say it the way we say it. And for me, it's about learning to play spiritual defense.
Yeah, because that's the question I wanted to ask you. Speak to that.
Well, I always thought I just had to play good offense. If I was surrendered to the Lord, if I was walking in holiness, if there was no compromise, if I understood scriptures and whatnot, that I'd have this powerful offense. But when I saw that Jesus walked away, that Jesus played defense, sometimes people would gather to stone him or to throw him off a cliff. And the scriptures are very clear. Jesus slipped through the crowd or he left that town. And I had this notion, boy, I think some listeners may be caught by this. Because Jesus died the death of a martyr, because he let himself be beaten and go to the cross. Okay, this is the abuse that comes from being a believer. I'm walking in the footsteps of Jesus. There may be a time for that, but this is key. Jesus let himself be crucified once. There is a pattern throughout his life where he walked away from many instances of intended persecution. And so if we walk in the footsteps of Jesus, there will be times we walk away. We don't have to let ourselves be beaten up. We don't have to let ourselves be torn apart. That in fact, we should be looking for where we can do the most good and not lose that time and effort and obsess over the fact that people will oppose us. I also dealt with the guilt of how do you write people out of your life?
It feels uncomfortable.
But the model of Jesus, here, I grew up in Washington State, which is famous for two things. Western part is famous for rain, justifiably. The eastern part is famous for its apples. Now, if you're going to grow great apples after you harvest, what are you doing? You're pruning those trees. You're cutting off. You're pruning the less fruitful that's draining the tree of its ability to produce good fruit. And there's times, I believe, in every believer's life when we have to prune some relationships that are keeping us from being fruitful. Now, before you say, that sounds so terrible, I'm quoting John 15.
No, I agree with
when
that.
When Jesus says, talks about, I'm going to prune that tree. I'm going to cast off those who aren't fruitful. I think in Christianity, we have emphasized piety over fruitfulness way too much.
Mm.
God's kingdom is built on workers. Jesus said, pray for the Lord of harvest to bring more tithes, to bring more people who don't look at inappropriate things. No, it's more workers. We need more workers. Jesus stresses fruitfulness as a big part of faithfulness. And so when we look at his life, we see how Jesus did this. One instance that I think is just so sad. Remember when Jesus delivered a couple men of demons and sent them into the herd of pigs? The pigs run off a cliff because the demons are filled. The people are... there's our livelihood. Our farming is gone. And I just look back and say, what would we today pay for a weekend to see the incarnate Jesus in person, to see him, to hear him, to ask him questions? You talk about a ticket. I mean, anybody listening to this program is thinking, I'll put that on the credit card. I want to see. Here they had Jesus incarnate. And what did they do? They chose pork chops over salvation. They basically said to him, please leave. This is the last verse in Matthew 8, the first verse in Matthew 9. So Jesus got in a boat and sailed away.
Hmm.
Jesus, look, I'm sorry. Let me explain what happened here. They said, we don't like what you've done. You deliver that man of demons, but you've wrecked our livelihood. Just get out of here. Jesus left. I think the rich young ruler, now there, I don't think it was toxic, but Jesus gave the hard truth to the rich young ruler and said, here's what you have to do. And he walked away. Jesus didn't go after him saying, look, 100%, that's a bit steep. we need support. How about we start at 50%? You know, I'm doing good business deals. You start with a bigger number. Instead, it said Jesus turned to his disciples, the reliable people, and said, this is why it's so difficult for rich people to come into the kingdom of God. Instead of chasing after the closed off person, he turned to the people that are reliable, that are ready to be taught. And he said, here's what's going on. So he let people walk away, or in Matthew, he walked away.
Gary, this is intriguing and very interesting topic that, again, we're not talking much about. So thank you for all the time and effort you've put into this great book, When to Walk Away. It feels a little uncomfortable, John, to even talk about it, but we need to. And let me speak to you, the listener. Maybe this conversation has stirred up some issues for you. Maybe you're thinking, I may be that toxic person. Mm. That's a good thing that you're looking at yourself and asking that question. I want to pat you on the back. Or you're the person who feels guilty that you're cutting these people off because they're sucking life from you. They are, John 10:10, there to steal, kill, and destroy you, as Gary has alluded to. I want to recommend you get a copy of Gary's book, When to Walk Away. It's a powerful resource. You need it, and I want to make this available to you. So for a gift of any amount, we'll send it as our way of saying thank you. If you can't afford it, we'll put it in your hands, and someone else I trust we'll take care of the cost of that.
And I'm thinking too, Jim, that there might be somebody that needs to talk to one of our caring Christian counselors here. Right? I mean, we've probably stirred some waters up. Yeah. And if that's
you. Thank you for having that.
If that's you, give us a call. Our number is 800, the letter A in the word family. You can connect with a counselor, order Gary's book, and donate to the ministry. Again, 800, the letter A in the word family, or online, we're at focusonthefamily.com/broadcast.
Gary, let's come back next time, continue the conversation, and cover more of this difficult territory. Can we do that?
You've got me wired up. I'm ready to go.
Let's go, man.
Well, on behalf of Jim Daly and the entire team here, thanks for joining us today for Focus on the Family. I'm John Fuller, inviting you back as we once again help you and your family thrive in Christ.